So I'm Rui, I'm your Meetup host today. I'm not the important guy today. The important guys are the speakers, and after the speakers you all become the most important people in this meeting. But I will just give you some guidelines on how things are going today. So we'll start with two talks, around 30 minutes each, plus 10 minutes Q&A if you have questions for the speakers. First one will be Marco Silva. Marco Silva is from this house, but is not representing Microsoft for any reasons, and we are not doing here the meetup for nothing related to that, but he will be talking about daily meetings and why daily meetings are not just standing and sharing stuff. Okay. The second one will be our Mr. Pereira, Nuno Pereira, and he will be talking about two things that for some weird reason he thinks are related, Agile and the Rock Band. I have no clue how is that possible, but Nuno will be trying to explain that to us. And then after an hour and something, we'll have some minutes to take your coffee break and to network a little bit more. And we'll be back here to explain how it works, the second part of the meeting. Who has attended the first one should be kind of aware of the mechanics of an open space, but I'll explain that later. So please, first round applause of tonight for Marco Silva.
So this is talk I did a couple of weeks ago, like almost a year ago. But I did it not in Lisbon, so, and they asked me to do it again here. So hopefully you didn't attend the first one. But who is Marco? So this is me. I'm from Portugal. I studied at Porto University. And I work for Microsoft. I'm a digital advisor for the telco and the retail space here in Portugal. Okay. So enough about me. So what I'm going to be talking about is based on an article that I read like a year ago. I don't know if you read it. If you didn't, please do. It's way cooler than the presentation, like any book. If you see the movie, the book is better, so it's the same thing. So basically, this is about my vision and this paper, and the mixture between the two. So a little bit about how change works. And this is, I don't want to give you an idea by the end of this presentation that you have like 10 things that you can change on your daily meetings or that are going wrong. So always keep in mind that change is something that your brain doesn't like. And if you go to your teams and try to change everything, there's a this part of the brain around here, this primitive part of the brain, that will block any change. There's a very cool book about this, The Spirit of Kaizen. I don't know if you know the word or what Kaizen means. This comes from the Japanese philosophy of continuous change by doing small change iterations. So this is why. Because small change will not trigger the primitive brain to go into overload and stop the change. This is the part of the brain that when you are seeing a lion and you're saying, like, your intelligent part of the brain will say, okay, distance from the lion, is it the big lion, is he hurt, is he... And then this part that says, shut up brain, start running. You will think about it later, and this is what happens when you're in stress. After stress, this part of the brain, primitive part, will let go, and then comes all the rush of information, and you can process this in one time. But if you do small changes, then this won't happen, and your intelligent part of the brain will be able to do the change. So keep this in mind whenever you see, this is a big change, this is a small change, pick the smallest ones and then build up to the big ones, okay? So this is what the Kaizen philosophy tells you. It talks about improvement and refers to activities that continuously improve all functions and involve all employees. This is very a very good definition that you can find in the podcast. So, all of this talk will be in this format, pros and cons. I'll try to do it as much as possible so it gets really simple and really fast, okay? Just for us to be all aligned in what we're talking about, and this is, for me, the definition of a stand-up meeting. And I think you all read it, is where a whole team meets every day for a quick sync update. We stand up and keep the meeting short. Okay, so this is typically what you can say about a daily meeting or stand-up meeting. What are, if you drill this into points, what will we see? You will see something like share and understand our goals, coordinate efforts, share problems and improvements, and really become a team. For me, these two are the most important parts of a daily stand-up. It's these two that make the daily stand-up work. And this is why in my teams I keep doing them, because if by nothing else, at that moment we are a team. We are helping each other and we have that conscience. So this is very important. So the first thing that I started thinking about when I was thinking, well, okay, I'm building this change, I'm going to push daily meetings on my team. So who's going to attend? And this is something that, depending on the teams, I had different approaches. One is, okay, so there's the all lines meeting. So everybody's in, the product owner, the customer, everybody's wanting to see it because it's new, and then you have a full house, and there's like five people there that really matter, and then you have 50 people there for some reason. So pros, it's great. You don't need to sync with everybody else. Okay, this is normally the reason that everybody says that they should do this. The other one is it brings everybody on board in process, so you're part of the process, so that's if you're included, then that's better for change. And it puts the responsibility on everybody. In truth is, because they saw it, because they heard it, and they didn't do anything, you can say, yeah, you heard it, you were there, I saw you. So you didn't do anything, so it's your fault as well. Okay, these are good pros, but the cons is there's no one directly involved. After a while, this works like the first five times, let's say, for the number that they're. But the truth is, after a while, everybody just simply disconnects because there's too much people. And then everybody wants to participate. No one knows the rules. They just start speaking. And you need to moderate that. And it becomes a real pain just to moderate this. It's really easy for you to get too many questions and begin one-on-one discussions because it's in the background. The guy is speaking, there's like six other people that's speaking to each other. They're like, what the hell, man? Shut up. It's really, really hard to do. To be honest, I tried it sometimes and then I quit it. Today, I only do it with the team. This is my personal opinion. I'm going to share a lot of my personal opinions. Keep in mind that everything will work or not depending on the case. And I have some places that I did this in different ways and it worked just because they're different. People are different. Work icons, they attend. This is another philosophy that's very interesting. Brian Myers said, if the stories are so important to the project, they ought to be the ones speaking at the stand-ups. This is a very interesting philosophy if you think about it. Because when you're talking about what you did, you're talking about tasks itself. So this is a different approach that I tried, and it's interesting. Instead of having everybody speak, we just go through the board and say, okay, so what's the status on this? Oh, and then the person that was working on this was just start, okay, I'm doing this, this is closed, it's okay, no, this has an impediment, okay, good. And everybody else would pitch in, and you would just go through the board and instead of going through the people. It works. It has an interesting format, and it helps not enter into the one-on-one discussion. You know, cons is this is basically you tend to share the problems, okay? Because you're looking at something that you did, and either you're reporting. It's not so much as a daily meeting; it's more like you're reporting stuff, and problems may stay hidden because of this. Because when you're reporting, typically you want to report the positive things because, hey, yeah, I did good. This is reporting, right? Because the difference between reporting and evaluation is so, in our minds, it's so little, it's so small. it tends to not say the problems, not share, just say, yeah, that's it, go forward. And then you skip the important parts. I should have removed this, but okay. Visual Studio can do this. I did this, I didn't change, sorry guys. I didn't remember that this was here. So, who presents in the daily meeting? So, how do you do it? What's the format? Normally, you would say these three questions, it works. I would say it works every time, okay? But just for you to know, there's other ideas that I try to. Another one, the goals here are to have a minimalistic structure that you could do and can explain and everybody could work on. Again, reporting is something that really is, this format gets into the reporting aspect really, really fast. But think about reordering the questions. Why would you say things? What's blocking me normally is the last question. When I was a Scrum Master, for me this was the most important one. And it was the one that you already talked a lot, and then you're looking at the time, my time is almost over, yeah, I have something, I'll talk to you later. Okay, this was the most important part, and you had the least amount of time. So by reordering them, you can get a really good aspect about the impediments. And well, what I did yesterday, this is the least important thing, because it's done. It's not that I'm not reporting again. So what I'm going to do today is more important than what I did yesterday, because it's already done. If I want to see what's done, there's a board that I could go to and just see it. Hopefully it's updated. Another very interesting thing is, this is something that happens every day. This should be something that creates momentum for the remaining of the day, especially if this is done at the beginning of the day. This is a moment that you could use to motivate your team. It's a little bit, it's a bit weird just to say things like I want to change the world yesterday. But if you read some psychology books, there's a lot of strength in words. Even if you don't notice, to say something out loud will change the way you do. If you say something every day, it will change the way you see it. There's some techniques that you could do in front of a mirror just to up your self-esteem, and it works. Okay, there's scientific data that will tell you and show you that it works. So think about it. Why not? Why not use this? It's science knowledge, right? Another thing is, why only three questions? If there's something that you want to change, think about Kaizen. This small change you can do, and I want to upgrade my quality of code. And for me, there's a problem in my project where, there's a low code coverage. Why not have this? So I did this, and this, and then at the end, and I did 10 unit tests yesterday. I did 20 in making the competition. So you can upgrade the questions, the format, so that you can have your goal, your small goal, into every day, the mindset of the team. So, but remember all this, Kaizen, okay? So don't do them all, especially because you won't be able, some of them don't intersect. So you will need to choose. And for me, I sometimes even remove the first question. Because to be honest, it's the one that everybody loses the most time because they want to show so much work that they did. And I don't care. I care more about the other two. So I have removed them for some things. Skip. So who talks next? This is something that sometimes bothers me a bit, because the round robin is the typical rule that you do. You just get around the room and just, you start, and then everybody knows that he's next. He's looking at the guy before, are you finished? Then I start. It's very easy, it's very simple to execute. You know, the main problem that I get to this is, I'm really attentive to the meeting up to the point that I need to speak. I will have zero interaction from this point forward. So if I'm a good team player, then I'll keep attentive to the rest of the meeting. But if I'm not, if by some reason I'm a little, well, I'm a little bit down on the weather that day or whatever, it's very predictive. So I know where my brain will disconnect. This is stronger than yourself. It's something that your brain will do by itself. If you want to disconnect, you'll disconnect, because it knows there's nothing coming again. So there's some other things that you could use to make your meetings a little better is, well, have the last guy who comes in, his guy needs to speak, so you don't want to be late, and at the same time, you solve the problem of order, because people will get in and now they have to remember what's the order of the people that came in, so they need to be attentive. The problem here is, after you spoke, then you disconnect, especially if you're late. Now you've been punished, and now you just, yeah, I don't care about this. But the truth is, it's a different approach. You could just shift it around. I did this one well, a lot, to be honest. Passing token, talking token, just to keep people, just people shut up during the meeting. It helps, and at the same time, you just go and pass the token around. But imagine that instead of having a token, you have a plush bear, something like that. Instead of passing around, you throw it around at the face of the next guy. And you just don't pass it around to the next guy, you pass it around to the other side of the room. This will make everybody attentive. Otherwise, you get. And if the guys don't get the aren't attentive to the meeting, aren't paying attention, then you can, well, instead of throwing a plush, then throw the ball, make it some hard ball, and people will get the idea and will start paying attention. So, I don't remember why I did this one, it's a quote, but I'll split the subjects. Oh, okay. This is something that that works on as well. If you split the areas, people will be more attentive. For instance, if you're talking about tasks that are have to do with testing or would have to do with the front end and the back end, you do all the tasks. So everybody is working on the front end. We'll speak together. This works a lot to have everybody sync on this subject. Problem with this one is when these guys they almost can leave. They almost have the feeling that I'm going to stay here because of the other guys. Yeah, was the first guy or the last guy is saying like, yeah. Okay, a lot of front-end stuff, yeah, get to the database, okay, it's my time. So, this has pros and cons as well. Oh, and another way that works a lot, and we do it in Microsoft as well, it's running from the board. You just go and look at the board, have the board there, and just go through it. And it's self-managed. You at that moment, you just update the board, and it gets over the hassle that everybody says that, okay, I need to go update my task yesterday, I didn't do, sorry. You do it at that moment and everybody's in sync. So, about the different formats, to be honest, like I said, pros and cons on everyone, so every single one of them. So, I tried a lot of them, they serve their purpose when they need to, and if you need to change, then change. This is my personal recommendation. Another thing that's very good about doing meetings is you need to keep the energy level up. It's 10 minutes, it's not that much time, but it is. I showed you the jump, the airplane then jump that I did. That's 5,000 feet. It took me one minute and a half, and it was the best minute and a half of my life. But it took a minute and a half, and it felt like 10 minutes. So time is relative, so you need to keep this in mind. If you're bored, then you're bored. And 10 minutes will feel like half an hour. There's some things, some techniques that you could do to get people attached to this moment and get the energy pumping in. At the end of the meeting, like the soccer players would do, you just go and say, okay, let's do a huddle. Just have a shout. Everybody gets in the mood. You get the blood pumping, you know, and it works. It works on them. It works on every team. They are a team, and they are more team after this than they were before. So it works. Oh, sorry. The stand-up part, you know, it works, builds some energy at your legs, you're not sitting down, you don't fall asleep, you're not in the sofa, it doesn't work. But you don't do this as well, okay? This is not setting up. This is leaning. There's three guys leaning and two guys standing up. That's not standing up. That's lean up meeting. It's completely different. So you have the 15 minutes or less. This is something that will keep your brain active around the time, keep your time, because you don't want to go over your time, because that means someone else's time is up as well. So time your meetings and make it as productive as possible. And don't be afraid to do this. Take it offline, especially if you're leading the meeting. This is something that I do a lot. If someone starts like really going long about what they did, and like, yeah, this is not an architectural discussion, please, let's take it offline. Please, really. Because especially if they started talking to each other, this is something that you really need to have the ability to interrupt people that are discussing and say, yeah, this is not the storytelling, this is not a discussion. For discussions, you have other meetings, not this one. The two hands up meeting, this the rule. This is very cool. I don't know if you know this one. This one is something that was told to me, and it's very cool. If you feel, because one thing is the Scrum Master needs to tell someone to shut up. If he's not attentive, or especially if he's taking part of that, then you have zero power, because you're not the Scrum Master. What can I go and say, shut up? He's the guy that should be doing it. So this is something that will give you the power, just in, okay? And then someone else said, yeah, they're speaking a lot, and then you have two hands up, three hands up. Someone will notice and say, yeah, we are talking a lot, sorry. This is a smooth, discreet way, polite way to say, yeah, shut up. And don't forget, end strong, have a work right. This is very good, this is cool. It's a little bit, well, if your team is a little bit skimmish about exposing themselves too much, like having a war cry may be not that good, but at the same time, to be honest, those teams are the ones that really need the push. So try to push them a little bit out of their comfort zone, and have a war cry will also get your energy. Okay. Finally, encourage autonomy. Something that works really well is to tag in a teammate, swap the guy that's facilitating the meeting, and have a different one on every meeting. This will help everybody be really aware of the problems that you as a team have. Because it's always the same guy that's needing to deal with the problems, then it's not the team's problem, it's his problem. Now it's everybody's problem, because no one's paying attention or whatever. Another way is to break eye contact. So if you need to remind someone that is addressing you, you're looking at him back, and then you need to just, okay, you're talking to me, then you break eye contact. And then you say, okay, I need to look someone else. And then you will realize this. It works really well. Because you only keep eye contact with the people that are, at least long eye contact with the people that are looking at you back. If you break it, you instinctively will break it as well. Will look for another icon, especially because this is normally because you're a little bit out of your comfort zone. You need to fix to something, and you're looking for support. You do this in presentations as well. So what should I do next? This is a very long quote about the change itself. You can read it later. And identify what's going poorly on your daily meeting. Look at the symptoms. Okay, try to watch your daily meeting as a spectator, and then see. Okay, so this went wrong. What can I do? And one of them is don't focus. And when you do this, don't focus on the runner. Focus on the two. Don't focus on how fast this guy or that guy, that individual person. Focus on what's happening. It's the symptom itself and not the person, okay? Don't personalize this when you're doing this. Especially when you're reporting back into the team, you're speaking too long at the team meeting. Don't do this. This will create a feeling of the team breaking apart. Instead, we as a team are speaking too. The problem is speaking too much and not that person that's doing it. he will feel that. The other problems that you could look at are the ones that if people are starting to report, try to look for those symptoms. Way too far, but okay. If people are getting to the meeting late, this is a very common problem, to be honest, for me. Stand-ups start the day or end the day. This is something that you need to feel if this works or not for your team, starting or ending. Different teams will have different responses to this. And the biggest problem I tend to see, especially with new teams, is they start socializing instead of doing work. And this is the most common problem, to be honest. Not the socializing, this is the most common. I don't remember what I did yesterday. This is a really strong tell that something is wrong. For me, if someone doesn't remember what they did yesterday or what he needs to do today, by this time, when he gets to the meeting, that he knows is going to happen, this is a strong tell. It's not that he didn't remember 5 minutes before the meeting started and then went up and looked it up. It's that he went to the meeting and then realized it. Oh, I don't have anything to say because I don't remember. This is a very strong tell that something is wrong. So, storytelling, I already told. Solving the problem is something that also happens a lot in meetings, and the low energy part. Just go there and that's awful. If you feel this, then you should try and change that energy. So, yeah. Remember, there's a lot of stuff in the slides. Sorry about the printer. So, but please remember, this is you need to. If you do change, if this, and from my personal goal was this, with this presentation was to get people to realize that, oh yeah, I see the symptom in my meetings. Oh, I see that and that. And if they saw 3 or 4, please remember that don't change them all. Because you'll scare the team and probably will have even more problems before that after this than before. Okay? So thank you very much, guys. Any questions?
You mentioned all these techniques to, you know, mess things a bit with the team. Yeah. That's the purpose, right? What's your experience on using these techniques when you are working with remote teams, people that are not physically present at the daily stand-up?
Normally, yeah. This is an excellent question because there's a lot of people now that's working remote. The truth is, some of these methods won't work remotely. Passing the baton, for instance, throwing it. Either you have really good IoT developers that will shoot stuff from your computers. It's going to be hard. But truth is, there's different problems when we're doing this type of meetings remotely. For me, the most important ones are energy, focus, because it's really easy for me just being on the call and just looking at the ceiling. Oh, look, the TV is on. Okay, I disconnected completely. I already shared. I didn't even know as a Scrum Master that the guy is really listening. So it's really hard for you to notice the problems. And this, for me, shaking it a bit will help you realize that something is wrong where you didn't see the problem because it was hidden by the Skype call or whatever. If you have stuff like the order is changing and you notice that everybody's like really messed up, what's happening? Because they weren't paying attention, because they were used to not paying attention. And then you realize that before, everybody wasn't paying attention. So this is what I think. My experience was that it will solve a difference. It will probably help you notice some problems. It will probably help you solve them as well. But there's probably more stuff that you could do on a remote meeting than some of this stuff. Thank you very much for your question.
Can I just some experience really working remotely with people in Portugal?
Yeah.
So four of us here and the rest of the team there. They do the meeting on a server.
Can you speak louder, please?
We're working with people in Porto. And the people in Porto, they put us in a laptop and they point to the person that is speaking because they're in a circle. and we are in a large screen. So we got to the conclusion that it was very important to have a visual aid, not just the conf call. When people were just listening, it was very hard to follow up the daily. But now with the chair, it's dynamic, we move around. And we try to use that as to keep people involved and seeing.
And everybody's moving around chair, or is something that someone is responsible for?
They make a circle and someone is in charge. When someone is speaking, some other person makes sure that we can see the person who's speaking. And they can see our reactions, or nodding, or not listening.
That's good, because then you get the feedback around, that you're doing the video. Most, another thing that I saw a lot in dinner meetings, I forgot to tell you, was do the video. It helps a lot, because you need to, you see the face of the person, and because everybody else knows that it's seeing your face, then you're not looking at the ceiling, especially you're not looking at the TV at home, you're really paying attention, because otherwise, like, what is this guy doing, like, working, what's happening, you're like, oh, sorry. So it works. Thank you for sharing.
I'm just going to show you what I'm thinking.
Yeah, sure.
I'm going to think out loud.
Yeah, please.
Okay. So I really like the way you presented and these tips that for me are quite common sense. Because this is common sense.
Okay.
And by saying this, I'm not simplifying.
No.
But that's the point for me. It's by doing that and knowing that we need to do that, and we say yes, of course, it makes sense for me. Good. And by doing it quite often, regularly, sometimes even by doing that, things don't go as you would like to.
Yeah.
So from your experience, now it's my question, right? From your experience, why sometimes those things work and other times they don't work at all?
Firstly and mostly, people are people. And the toughest part of any project isn't the technology, isn't the problem that you're solving, it's going to be the people that are doing it. So this is really tough. People are different, and people change at the same time. And another thing is, humans have this nice, nasty habit of really getting used to something and then disregarding it, or take it for granted. And normally we're very excited when something is new, and then really bored after some time has passed. So if my changing stuff iteratively, then your comment is going to be change, and you're never going to be used to change. This is the only thing that humans will never be used to, is changing. I'm used to change, but I'm really always excited about the new stuff that's coming in. If I stop changing, I won't feel the difference between that. I'm going to start get used to it. And then production will go down, you'll take stuff for granted, and then it's everything will go well, I think. This is my personal opinion. I personally try to change something on a regular basis on my routine, my personal and work life. And it helps me a lot. I'm always on my feet. So for the team, should be the same thing. But at the end of the day, what will work with one team, and when changing, if you change constantly, what I think is, you'll fail sometimes and then succeed some other times. Your average is what's matter.
And did you ever the need to stop changing the way you lead a team and change someone from the team?
To be honest, yes. I had to remove some people from one team to move it to another because the dynamics weren't working, and everybody was aware that the dynamics weren't working. And then I don't like to do this, and this is something I really try to avoid. But the truth is, if the dynamic isn't working because of one person, I left it behind. I left that person behind, moved it to another team because we needed to get the job done. At the end of the day, that's what matters. And if the team works well, then that person also has to understand that if this wasn't good for him as a person, because he was swimming against the current, and that current was really strong, a lot more people that were doing this than he trying to push it away. and you get those people as well. This type of structure, especially Agile, isn't for everybody, because if you really like the structure, really steady job approach, really 9 to 5, and my job starts here and ends there, and this is your responsibility, I'm not a team player. If my mindset is this, then I'm not a team player. And it's really hard to build a team without team players. So, yes, truth is, sometimes you need to change the person as well. But I didn't do it a lot of time, I did it once, to be honest.
Thank you.
Thank you.